This is the last lecture, and our goal today is to prove the Conley conjecture. We are in the middle of studying symplectically degenerate maxima. Let's recall that an isolated periodic orbit X is called an SDM if the local Floer homology of X is non-zero in degree, the mean index of X plus N. This is exactly the very extreme edge of the possible support of the symplectic homology. So the support of the local Floer homology is contained in the interval mean index minus n mean index, the mean index plus n. So this is the very edge of the support. In particular, the rightmost point of the rightmost endpoint of the interval has to be an integer, as Eli pointed out. So this then, of course, necessarily implies that the mean index is an integer. So an observation and it's not really necessary, but it's convenient to think this way, is that by replacing the flow of H, by composing the flow of H with a contractible loop, at least local contractible loop, in HAM, I can always make X into a constant periodic orbit. So it's just convenient to think of X as a constant periodic orbit. Properties. Before properties, examples. We looked at several examples last time, and basically the main class of examples we want to think of is local strict degenerate maxima. Something like negative P to the fourth plus Q to the fourth, or something like negative, something like lambda, where lambda is positive, P squared plus Q to the fourth. This is still a very degenerate maximum, whatever lambda is, from the symplectic perspective. So these are the examples to keep in mind. Properties, so simple properties. One, the first one we already mentioned, that X is an SDM, then X is strongly degenerate. All eigenvalues are equal to 1. So let's replace this lambda by something. This is not an eigenvalue. And the reason is that when X is weakly non-degenerate, if there is an eigenvalue different from 1, the inclusion is into an open interval. Two. X is an SDM, then X to the K is necessarily and is automatically isolated and an SDM. And the reason here is that, well, first of all, if X is strongly degenerate, that also implies that all positive integers are admissible. Then by the persistence of the local Floer homology theorem, this sort of I'm proving this part that the local Floer homology of X to the K, now as I know K is admissible, is the local Floer homology of X with some shift. And when we go back and look at what the shift is, we see that the shift is exactly, I think the shift as K in this case will be delta times delta of X to the K minus delta of X. We know how the homology changes and it changes it the right way. If you remember, the idea was that under iterations, you just take the homology and shift it to the right. Three is that X is an SDM if and only if X to the K is an SDM for sufficiently large primes. And one can think of this as a criterion. And this is how we are going to use. In one direction, of course, a stronger statement holds that if X is an SDM, you get an SDM for all iterations. But the other way around, if something happens to be an SDM for a sufficiently large prime, then it got to be an SDM to start with. And the so the proof of three is also very simple that so XK is an SDM means that XK is totally degenerate by 1. Now, if K is sufficiently large prime, greater than all roots of unity among the eigenvalues of X, then that means that X is totally degenerate. And then by the, again, the persistence of local Floer homology, to get the local Floer homology of X, I need to take the local Floer homology of X to the K up to the up to a shift, and the shift is exactly the right thing. So these are all easy consequences. One thing to keep in mind here is that the converse in two is not true. So you can start with something and end up with an SDM after several iterations. So this is not true. Now, with this in mind, we can prove the first non-degenerate case of the Conley conjecture. So let's recall what we are proving here. W is symplectic collabial. And phi h is a Hamiltonian diffeomorphism of W with a finite fixed point set. Then for every sufficiently large prime, this is the case of the Conley conjecture. For every sufficiently large prime k, there exists a simple k-periodic order. There are two cases. The so-called the so-called non-degenerate case. And in this case, none of, so this is the case where none of the x1, none of the fixed point is an SDM. And that's a very easy proof. And this is where the assumption that the first Chern class is zero becomes particularly important. So because let's do the proof now. The proof in this case, assume not. K is a large prime. And all periodic, and there are no simple periodic orbits of, and there are no simple K periodic orbits. Then because K is prime, all periodic orbits are the iterations of these guys. So, and because the first Chern class is zero, for each orbit x, the Conley-Zender index, when it is non-degenerate, or the mean index, are defined. Without any capping, without any ambiguity. This is absolutely essential. So we have this assumption, and we are going to arrive at a contradiction. What can happen? Let's take one of these points, xi to the k. So let's look at xi. Two things can happen. One thing is that the mean index of xi is non-zero. then the support of the local Floer homology of xi to the k is inside the interval k delta, k times the mean index of xi minus n, and k times the mean index of xi plus n. This number is just delta of xi to the k because the mean index is homogeneous. And when k is large, this interval is either far to the right or far to the left. So it does not contain n. In other words, the local Floer homology of xi to the k in degree n is 0. The second possibility is that the mean index is 0. Then the support of the local Floer homology of xi to the k, well, the same formula holds, but the mean index now is 0. So it's contained in negative 1, negative n to n. But in fact, n is not here because xi is not an SDM. And therefore, again, so n is not here, and therefore, again, HF, the local Floer homology in degree n is 0. And if you remember, the local Floer homology groups are building blocks for the global Floer homology. If for all fixed points, the local Floer homology vanish in some degree, then the global Floer homology vanish in some degree, and the upshot is that the global Floer homology of H in degree n is 0, and this is of course impossible because the manifold has the fundamental class. Yeah, but not if k is large prime. So this implication fails when k is not prime. When k is not a large prime. So k got to be divisible by one of the by the degree of one of the roots of unity. Yeah, that's number three. X is that's number three. So that's pretty much how. Kind of by number three by three. So this argument is essentially due to Solomon and Zander. Probably around, 92? Of course, it's not how they phrased it, but this is essentially what they proved. Now it remains to prove is that We need to show this is that if one of the points is an SDM, then the assertion holds. And kind of the key idea here is due to Hingston, who realized that, who actually realized this dichotomy, that the Salomon-Zender argument goes through unless you have an SDM, and if you have an SDM by a different argument, the result holds. The logic is, sort of general logic is, that we use this information, sort of local dynamical information about SDM, to learn something about the Floer homology. And translate that to periodic coordinates. So this is actually the hard proof of the hard part of the theorem. It took probably on the scale of more than 15 years to do that part. Now, studying simplistically degenerate maxima, the hard part. So throughout this discussion, I will assume that X is a constant periodic orbit and an SDM. So a theorem and a geometrical characterization of SDMs. This is Hingston and myself, independently, mainly Hingston. X is in a constant orbit and an SDM. Then, for any epsilon greater than zero, there exists a Hamiltonian KT near X with the same time one map, and again X a constant orbit for KT. In other words, X is a fixed orbit, the time one map fixed, but I'm modifying a Hamiltonian. So I can get the same map by a Hamiltonian with some specific properties. It's not so, I mean, this is a local result, sort of near, it's defined near X. I'm not saying it has zero support, I'm just saying everything in this, this is a local lemma. It does not really kind of matter. Here is X, and I'm changing the Hamiltonian, keeping the time one map. So with the following properties, Y, K sub T has a strict local maximum at X. Two, the norm of the Hessian of K at X is small, less than epsilon. Three, let's look at the loop, so this says that the flow of K is some loop times the flow of H. Let's look at this loop. The linearization of the loop, this is now a loop in the linear symplectic group, is contractible. And as a remark, I'll get to that in a second. So the upshot here is that, so sort of the that these examples are fairly representative, that given an SDM, I can give it, I can generate it by a Hamiltonian with a fairly degenerate maximum. I can probably ensure actually that all eigenvalues are zero, but I don't quite remember that. In any event, what I can guarantee is that the Hessian is small. So in this example, it would be rescaling in one direction, in rescaling making A small. So this is the first part here is by far the most important. In addition, actually, and this is also important, but won't be one figure in the proof anyhow in the part we are going to discuss here, is that actually one can make time dependence of K also very minor. So one remark is that the last condition is equivalent to the fact that the Maslow index, and in this case, the Maslow index is simply the mean index of the loop is zero, and this is what you're going to verify. And so this is equivalent, and this is also equivalent that the loop at a T extends to a global loop in global contractible loop in Ham of W. And this implies that K extends to W as a Hamiltonian with the same time one map as H. That W? But the lemma is local. The lemma holds in the neighborhood of X.
So, how to define D new T?
Say it again?
D new T. Well, how to define D new T?
Well, I mean, new is a loop fixing X. Because K, well, I did not say it, but here, but let's say it with D of kt at x equal to zero. So let's say this. So this is kind of, this is a statement about germs near x. But the last part allows me to extend everything globally. So this is actually a non-trivial lemma, and let me outline the, there is an idea there. Idea of the proof. So fine SDM. It implies it's totally degenerate. And that implies that after possibly a change of coordinates, I can make it C2 small on a small neighborhood of X. Namely, I know that the linear part has all eigenvalues equal to zero, possibly some non-zero term, but eigenvalues equal to zero. So by linear change of coordinates, I can make the, so C1 is then C1 small, sorry. I can make it small. Actually, I can make it C2 small too, right? But, and then by shrinking the neighborhood, I can make everything. So CK, I can make it as small as I wish. So now again, I'm going to use the Weinstein theorem, and I'm going to write W, but everything is local. So this is the diagonal in W. This is the X. And this is the graph of phi. So it's, once I use the identification of a neighborhood of the diagonal with the cotangent bundle, so it becomes the graph of some df. Let's replace it. In the cotangent bundle. This, this f is a generating function in a very naive classical sense. And then the local Floer homology of x is equal to the local Morse homology of this generating function up to a shift of degrees. So I conclude then that the local Morse homology of X is non-zero in the top degree. And here is an observation. It probably, certainly Nancy Kingston knew this. It's probably very classical. So an observation. Let's kind of also note that X is an isolated critical point of F, an observation. An isolated critical point of F is a strict local maximum if and only if the Morse homology in the top degree is non-zero. And actually, for the record, I want to say that if and only if the homology in the top degree is non-zero, and in all other degrees, zero. It's actually a nice, no, it's not a nice, it's an exercise, but it's a tedious exercise to check this. So With this in mind, I know that X is a local maximum of F. So if I put C2, if I put C1 small here, then F is C2 small. This is just the graph of F. Now my Hamiltonian diffeomorphism is given by a generating function, which is pretty much pretty much meets all the requirements. The Hessian is small. It has a strict local maximum. And what remains to do is to turn this generating, it has a strict local maximum. And now I just need to turn this generating function into a time-dependent Hamiltonian generating generating function. And it's actually, the very first idea how to do it works. Namely, I want to define the flow of the time-dependent Hamiltonian by just taking the graph of F and contracting it to zero. So I say this is the graph of T times dF. I think the Hamiltonian you get from this condition will satisfy all the requirements. It won't be one periodic in time. So you need to do an extra correction to make it one periodic in time. And kind of this is, all of this is somewhat tedious, but the key idea is here. As a side remark, we actually kind of a side remark is that we proved another property of an SDM out of this, that if something is an SDM, that it has the homology concentrated in only the top degree. In the homology in all other, the Floer homology in all other degrees is zero. So in fact, kind of in terms of this support interval, if you get homology non-zero either here or there, then it is zero everywhere else. And this is a non-trivial piece of information, but we won't need it. Now, let's prove the, now we are ready sort of to prove the degenerate case. This is the case where one of the points, say x1, is an SDM. So observe that kind of in terms of the logic, this is done. Sorry, it's not done yet. My mistake. But at least I got some handle on local dynamics near an SDM. At least I got some understanding here. Now I'm going to state, I'm going to translate it to to Floer theoretical information. So I have a symplectic manifold. I either have to assume that it is weakly monotone or work with virtual cycles. I don't need it to be Calabi-Yau at this stage. I have a Hamiltonian diffeomorphism and an isolated fixed point, which is an SDM. Let's call see the action of it, and to have the action defined, I need actually some capping, but it's an SDM even as a capped thing. Then, for any epsilon greater than zero, there exists k of epsilon, a large positive integer, such that for any iteration greater than that number, the filtered Floer cohomology in degree n plus 1 for the interval kc, kc plus epsilon of the kth iteration is non-zero. This Kc is a point in the action spectrum, so strictly speaking, I need to write here Kc plus little delta. I need to move away from the action spectrum. Now, in the framework we discussed here, this statement even does not make any sense or does not make much sense when W is not rational, just because it's not entirely clear what this means. And this is kind of a part of what Doris did, is to sort of, you need to be careful defining this. So that's a non-trivial task. And one way to think about this theorem is that somewhere in this interval, there should be a point of index n plus 1 that kills the simplistically degenerate maximum. I'm going to prove this theorem in a sec, but first, let's see how the Conley conjecture follows from it. And I'm going to focus again on the Calabi-Yau case to start with, even though there are sort of other cases. So I'm deriving the degenerate case of the theorem. Let me focus on the fixed points with positive mean indices. The rest of them don't won't matter. Well, X1 is an SDM, so I'm starting with X2. So if k is a large prime, so let's make it sufficiently large so that k times the mean index is greater than 2n plus 1. Then the local Floer homology of the xi to the k is necessarily zero in degree n plus one, because the interval supporting it is too far to the right to contain this point. And therefore I have a contradiction. Therefore, I got to have a new point to generate this, homology. End of the proof. Observe that this proof absolutely did not use the action interval at all. This theorem actually implies more than the Conley conjecture in the non-degenerate case. For instance, here is another application. Let's say you have a rational manifold, but the collabial, but it does not have to be collabial, just a rational manifold. Then if it has an SDM, then the Conley conjecture holds. So the degenerate case of the Conley conjecture actually holds in a variety of other settings. For instance, this applies immediately to monotone or negative monotone manifolds, to a huge class of manifolds. It's not as accurate as the that version. I am not saying anything about the periods, but nonetheless it holds. Here is another little theorem. So this is GG. This is again GG. So let's say W to N again irrational. Then, even though I don't know, even though the Conley conjecture does not have to hold, I know I have a lower bound on the number of simple periodic orbits, and this is something like the minimal churn divided by the dimension. So if the minimal churn is large, you have a huge number of periodic orbits. One can think of it as a variant of the Arnold conjecture. This number is of course can be of course much bigger than the sum of Betti numbers, but these are not fixed points. These are not one periodic orbits. These are orbits of all possible periods. But of course, the number here can also be frustratingly small. All right, so here is the theorem we need to prove, and now I have to prove it, and unfortunately the proof is a little bit of anticlimax. It's boring. But also, unfortunately, this is the only proof I know. And I would probably put it strongly, it's the only sort of proof in existence, at least written up. At least that works for general symplectic manifolds. Nancy's proof is entirely different, but it's kind of specific to the torus, and nobody understands it well enough to translate it to symplectic language, including myself. So. All right. By the geometrical characterization, now, in terms of this diagram, I'm done with this part. This is the Floer theoretical information. So I just need to complete this implication. Geometrical characterization, I can assume that H is equal to K near X. In other words, I can extend K as we observed here and just replace H by K, but I want to keep the notation H. So in other words, X is an SDM of H, and H satisfies 1 through 3. Here is the picture. W X H. I'm going to do something which is absolutely standard trick nowadays. So I'm going to put a bump function slightly below H, sort of touching it from below, and sort of a bump function slightly above, sort of, this is almost flat, actually flat. Then it goes down. Because H has a local maximum, I can go down a little bit. But then H may increase. So I go down, stay flat here, and go up again to accommodate H. Let's give these functions names, F minus and F plus. One can, from the local conditions, one can actually choose these functions to be independent of time. I did not say it, but that's the fact that age depends on the on time very mildly. So now the standard squeezing trick. Let's call C again the action on some keeping of X, and I want F plus and F minus. So, X is a constant orbit. Let's just take it with the trivial capping. So the action is equal to the value of the Hamiltonian. Let's call this interval I. Then what I want to show is that the map from the local Floer homology of F plus to the local Floer homology of in degree N plus 1 of each to the local Floer homology of F minus is non-zero. So if I know this map is non-zero, I'm done. These are autonomous Hamiltonians. So I need to write like the case iteration somewhere. But these are autonomous Hamiltonians. So I can just multiply them by k. So once I know this map is non-zero, I'm done. Now, with this picture, I pretty much have gotten rid of any complexity. These are totally standard Hamiltonians of a very simple form. Sort of, in fact, for R2n, we calculated with Bashak for a totally different reason. Actually, in a more general setting, this homology and this this map, like many years ago, this like one of those instances when it is useful actually to calculate Floer homology for a specific Hamiltonian. So let's look at this a little bit closer. So I need to show this. This is what remains to show. Let's see what the picture looks like here now. The picture is, here is my W. I have a ball here. I have a bump function. And then I have another bump function. So this innermost bump is very small, kind of very low. But after I multiply it by k, so this is plus, of course. After I multiply it by k, it becomes very large. So now I have, now the picture is something like this. So in fact, I have one nearly flat bump function, another nearly flat bump function, and of course, it's totally reasonable that I have an isomorphism in Floer homology. So in fact, here I have Z2, here I have Z2. One can sort of, one way to think about this is that in degree n, I have a maximum here, a maximum there. So in degree n, I have an isomorphism of something like kc minus delta, kc plus delta of kf plus to the same thing for f minus. Just sending maximum to the maximum. And this map is an isomorphism from a long, from the long exact sequence. There is one, so that's one way to think about it. There is something to take care of here. And namely, this is the, after all, there are other parts of the manifold here to worry about. Like, you know, what happens, after all, there are all these degenerate points, and these two points, possibly with cappings, or Floer trajectories going into other parts of the manifold. So here is a little tool developed to take care of these issues. So let F on W be constant on some shell S. So that's a shell enclosing a region U. Let's consider a part of the Floer complex of F generated by critical points, periodic orbits. And cappings in U. So here inside U, I have some dynamics, I have periodic orbits, and whatever cappings I'm going to work with, they're also in U. Then, if I allow only for small energy, this will be a subcomplex. And the reason is very simple, that for a Floer trajectory to go through this flat part, well, it's holomorphic here. By monotonicity, it got to have some energy. So this is a subcomplex when the length of the interval is small. Moreover, it actually a direct summand in the total Floer complex. And therefore, it is a direct summand in the Floer homology. Moreover, this decomposition is invariant under homotopies as long as this requirement is satisfied in the process of the homotopy. In fact, the constant need not be constant on the need not be the same on the shell. So the value of the constant is allowed to change. So now I'm going to apply this observation to the picture here. This will be my U, and this is the shell. So this is U, and this is the shell. So I'm going to take the homotopy down. I have the KF plus. Which decomposes as KF plus U plus something. The homotopy here to HFi KF minus U plus something. And this term depends only on U. So I can calculate it anywhere. I can calculate it in R to N. And it's pretty easy to see it's non-zero. Therefore, this is non-zero. And therefore, that is non-zero. Now, this does not work exactly. And this is non-zero, and the homotopy here is just pulling this stuff down. It's important that it stays constant here on the shell. this is this part. Here I want it to be constant. It kind of separates everything, and the interval is small. Epsilon is small. One has to, now, this works only when the manifold is rational. Otherwise, action spectra become dense and it all breaks down. So what Doris did and before her Michael Asher did in some case is actually, rather than keeping this part flat, you add it, you give it a little slope. And this is enough to get like the same energy separation. So that's the end of the proof. I started at 9:30. I still have some time. That's kind of unexpected. So I'm going to prove something else then. Yeah. So, let's look at this bump function. Let's look at this bump function. I want to understand the Floer homology of this bump function. Here is the maximum. Let's look at the periodic orbits of, you get here, the, you have periodic orbits here, and these guys I don't want to care about. So let's look at the Floer complex of this. You have the maximum, it has degree n, then you have this guy, it's degenerate, it splits into two orbits. One has degree n plus 1, another one has degree n plus 2. This differential is non-zero. So these two things are this orbit. Then I have the next orbit. This thing. Degree n plus 3 and n plus 4. And the Floer differential works like this. What is this gap? This gap is roughly the pi r squared, the r is the radius of this thing. So this gap is bounded from above by the displacement energy of the bump function. So this is the epsilon. Now let's take another bump function. And let's take a homotopy between them. They're touching each other. So I want to do something like this. I'm going to take the, let's call this value C. I'm going to take the interval C minus delta, C plus epsilon in degree n. This is zero for both of them, for either of them, just because what you have in degree n is maximum killed by this orbit. So when I look at the map for the range C minus delta, C plus delta, from F plus to F minus, this is an isomorphism. transcendent maximum to the maximum. So maximum goes to itself. Which means that it all, so let's sketch it slightly better. So here is an innermost bump function. This guy is that guy. The yellow is the other way around, strictly speaking, in this picture. This guy is the yellow guy. Here I have the orange guy, the same orbit but for f minus. And the long exact sequence tells me that because the, together they give they have zero homology, and this is an isomorphism, I have to have an isomorphism HF C plus delta C plus epsilon for F plus to HF C plus delta C plus epsilon for F minus N plus 1, N plus 1, sending the yellow orbit to the orange orbit. So that's this proof, kind of from a slightly different perspective. So this, this picture has been known for 15 years. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, I'm not sure I'm kind of answering your... it only works for the... Well, no, absolutely not. Well, yeah, ultimately what makes it work is that the maximum goes to itself. So this part of the diagram makes it work. As far, of course, in like in this picture, you expect other orbits to sort of be mapped to each other, and it's probably the case. But in some sense, we don't care. In some sense, we don't care. So this proof is indeed a little bit of anticlimax. It's kind of the moment I understood from Kingston's paper kind of this, that this is true, and it became clear to me that one can do the rest. So there are maybe several other theorems I wanted to prove. Let me just very briefly say I mean, there are of course many things to do with the Conley conjecture, but perhaps one of the most interesting part is what happens when it fails. So let me say a few words about this theorem Bashak, I think, mentioned already, and I want to just very briefly outline the proof of it. So the conjecture is, remember the Hofer-Zender conjecture, that if you have a Hamiltonian diffeomorphism of CPN, then with more than n plus 1 fixed points, then you have infinitely many periodic orbits. This is high dimensional generalization of Rank's theorem. And it's not immediately, I'm not sure whether I believe it, literally as stated, kind of. Every once in a while, I try to construct a counterexample. It might be a purely two-dimensional phenomenon without extra assumptions. For instance, it's considered, yeah, here is a challenge. It's conceivable that you can have more than n plus 1 fixed points if these fixed points have zero local homology, if they're sort of homologically negligible. So I... This would be a very mild counterexample, but nonetheless, this would be a counterexample to the conjecture stated. Here is some approximation to the theorem, Bashak. I stated it, and I think Bashak mentioned it. So let's take phi sub h from CPN to itself with a hyperbolic orbit. Then it has infinitely many simple periodic orbits. For if I could replace hyperbolic by non-elliptic, I would prove the high dimension of Rank's theorem. Because if you have more than n plus 1 by Floer theory, you got to have something non-elliptic. For CP2, kind of the only two things you can have non-elliptic are in the non-degenerate case, either like fully hyperbolic or a product of hyperbolic and elliptic. So that's kind of one remaining case. But nonetheless, we don't know how to do it. Here, the proof is entirely different. So here is a theorem. X is a hyperbolic orbit. And U, a Floer trajectory, asymptotic to x to the k on one end. And the other end outside a neighborhood of x. Let's say crossing a neighborhood U of X. Then the energy of this Floer trajectory is bounded from below by some positive constant independent of the order of iteration. So again, as usual, it's in simply to think of X as a constant orbit, as a so here is a neighborhood of X, and the Floer trajectory U then looks like something like this. It enters U and then approaches asymptotically the. So then the energy required to cross U is bounded away from zero by a constant independent of K. This is absolutely not true for elliptic points. For elliptic points, you can approach an elliptic point with an arbitrarily small energy, if you choose your iterations right. Let's take the sphere. Let's take an irrational rotation of the sphere. Here is the maximum. Here is the minimum. And let's look at, let's call the value here 0. Let's call the value here lambda. Let's look at the action spectrum for the case iteration. The action spectrum for the case iteration is Z union with K lambda plus Z. It's in one-to-one correspondence with recappings of the minimum and the maximum, with lambda here an irrational point. Now, if k is sufficient, there is a sequence of k's going to infinity such that the gap in the spectrum goes to zero. So they will be, when k is, one can find two points with sufficiently small gap, one point here, another there, with arbitrarily small gap when k is large. And for any two points here, there are always holomorphic solutions of Floer trajectory connecting them. So this shows that the theorem absolutely fails for in the elliptic case. Of course, when k is fixed, this is true for any isolated point. So the emphasis here is really on the dependence on the order of iteration. Now, the conjecture is here, which I think is probably impossible to prove, that if I look at the inf of energies for a fixed k, so far, I know it's bounded away from zero. So the conjecture is that the energy needed to do this crossing for k goes to infinity. That actually, as you iterate your elliptic point more and more, the energy required to cross a fixed neighborhood goes to infinity. It gets more and more expensive. So I'm going to prove the theorem assuming conjecture without the proof. How to derive that theorem from this theorem is rather involved, but it follows from the conjecture easily. So that's kind of an argument of a totally different flavor. Here is our elliptic orbit, and I will sort of draw orbits and the corresponding action values on the line. So I'm assuming that the action value of the elliptic orbit, let's say, is zero. Then to connect it by a Floer, and then it is the same zero for all iterations. So here is x to the k. Then as the order of iteration grows, I can find larger and larger interval containing zero where the orbit x is not connected to anything by a Floer trajectory. In particular, it's actually closed and non-zero cycle. For actions in this interval. So now I'm going to look at the quantum homology of CPN and observe that if I take the cycle, well, there are two cycles. One would be the point. It doesn't really matter which cycles these are. One point, another one is CPN minus one, quantum product, equal to Q times the fundamental cycle, times the fundamental class. So multiplying by this amounts to recapping. Let's denote this cycle E, this class B. And I'm going to use the well-known fact that the Floer homology is a module over the quantum homology. And in fact, the filtered homology, Floer homology is also a module over the quantum homology. If I keep track of the filtration. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to take this cycle and multiply it by A. And then I'm going to multiply it by B. And when I multiply it by B, it's the same as, by both A and B, it's the same as recapping it. As a result, when I multiply by A and B, actually what I have is non-zero. Therefore, there got to be a, so here I have, so to say, x to the k acted on by A, and here I have the recapping of that. So as a result, I have a holomorphic, I have a solution of Floer equation going from x to the k to somewhere. Well, this, the energy of this solution is bounded away from by the is bounded above from by the total energy here, and this difference is pi. So this is a solution U with, or this comes with a solution U of energy, or sorry, of energy e less than pi. It can be very small. So it can be something like this. But then, the, so if it is very small, then this part, which connects whatever is here to a recapping of my hyperbolic orbit, which is again a hyperbolic orbit, has large energy. So either this part has energy greater than pi over 2, or that part has energy greater than pi over 2. Okay, good. So either this part is, has small energy. So either the picture is like that, or like this. So one of the two parts got to have energy smaller than pi over 2, or even smaller than pi. I'm actually already good. I assume the conjecture. I assume that the crossing energy goes to infinity. And here I have the crossing energy less than pi, a contradiction. So I found a trajectory with energy smaller than pi. But the assumption is that the conjecture is that the energy goes to infinity under the order of iteration. So these solutions of Floer equation don't come from the differential. They are sort of higher dimension moduli spaces. And they come from the action of the quantum homology. In any event, this is just to give you a flavor, this is a totally different phenomenon involved. Now I think I've covered like, at least two thirds of what I planned. We have a survey. So if you want to sort of read about this, I pretty much followed the survey actually in this lecture notes. Maybe a year or two back we published a little survey on the Conley conjecture. It's actually not very long. And still very much up to date. It's called, the title is the same as the lecture, the Conley conjecture and beyond. And it's in the R-Node Math journal. So if you want to read more about this, it's readily available and kind of fairly elementary. Let me stop here. Thank you.